Today I just want to stand before I start to speak, but what I'm presenting here is not only for me. So it's work of collaborators, it's things I did myself and things I did at all. So it's a mixture. So I'm going to go through human migrations, a kind of journey from out of Africa, and we will focus slowly more and more into the details, and of course we will focus towards New Zealand. Something else, of course the guy on the right side is not a Maori, I know, but it's just to highlight, if you look at a map, this is an aborigine from Australia. You can think that it could be a putative source of settling of New Zealand because it's not far away. But as you know, these guys are bad sailors, so it's the wrong story. But it's just geography doesn't tell you everything. So you start from a very large picture. This is a tree using the same kind of molecular markers my colleagues used before in ancient DNA, so mitochondrial DNA. And this is the picture you can have when you sequence different big apes. So you have gorillas, you have chimpanzees and so on, and the humans, the modern humans, so you and me, we are in red. So the very important thing you have to see in this picture is simply that we have a very, very low genetic diversity. This is because we have this strong, with many short branches. The longer the branch is, the more diversity you will have. So we see we are far less diverse than chimpanzees. And even humans between, for example, New Zealand and Europe, they have less diversity, genetic distance, than two chimpanzees that are far, something like 100 kilometers apart. So we are very, very bottlenecked people. So this is kind of the effect of the out of Africa. Because few people left, and the genetic diversity went through a bottleneck. Also, I will also speak a lot about calibration and more technical parts. I will try to make it simple to you. Why we try to calibrate clocks? Because if you want to tell a complete story, you want to tell when people came, where they come from, and when they arrived. So you need a clock. So it's another factor. Of course, human migrations fascinated humanity forever. And this is just the kind of pictures people had in the 19th century. Here it's the picture from Ernst Haeckel, which is trying to map his ideas about human migrations in the past. And this was done something like 150 years ago. And it's quite excellent. When you look at it, you can see that, okay, people start here from the paradise. This is kind of the influence of religion, of course, in Germany, conservative country. But after people start to leave Africa, they go into Europe, they follow the main coast, they go through the Bering Strait, they go to North America, then to South America. And this another picture here is what we call today the express train of Polynesia. This is all these settlements of the islands through migrations and sailors. That's the picture, it's 150 years ago. And basically we will tell you all the same again 150 years later. So there's not much information we brought really after this. But details. If you want to reconstruct the history of humanity and of recent populations, you need to look at ethnic groups which are very isolated, who reflect the past history, and not the modern people who are hybridizing. We have a mixture, we have inter-ethnic marriages. This is a kind of destroying the signal. So ethnic groups are extremely important to collect the past history. So this is just a picture which shows you how many are left today, and most of them are declining, if not extinct. Should I speak about the race concept? Maybe. So this concept is just what also we saw this before in the session of Froment, where morphology and all these kinds of measures are reflecting some reality, some genetic background. So of course skin color is driven by genes, as well as hair color, hair structure, and so on. So these factors were in the past used as good indicators of our history and how to retrace the link between populations. Just an illustration to show the different phenotypes you might encounter. We also can gather information from other kinds of factors, not just genetics. We can also look at languages, you saw it before, in the talk before, but just if you're interested in languages, you can see that this is a blue. It's the same color you can see here in the Malay Peninsula, you can find in Taiwan and so on. It's what you call the Austronesian languages. So it's a good indication that there's a common ancestry, not only common language. The picture we have, if you put everything together, is not that good, finally, concerning the Pacific settlements, because you see between 5,000 years and 100 years, they say the big Pacific was settled. It's quite a large picture. It's not precise. It's not a real tempo. So we will try to see if we can do a better job. So, as I said, something is wrong with us. We have very few genetic diversity. If I would take two genes here, I sequence everybody in the room, and I will sequence the genes, I will have maybe no mutation at all. We will have all the same sequence. It's not informative at all. So we need things who are more polymorphic. So the consequence of this is that we have a weak genetic structure as humans, followed by these extreme bottlenecks. So questions are left, and today I will just spot one, the sources of the pollinations. So what we use here is what we call is indirect evidence. If you like wine, as I do, this is a bottle of wine which is very famous, it's a Chateau d'Yquem, and this castle is making one of the best sweet wine, licorice wine, and it's the consequence of a Botrytis cinerea, it's a fungi, who grows on the grapes, and it makes it the way that the wine loses water, so it gets more sweet. And sweet, sugar, means more alcohol. And if you don't have this Botrytis growing some years, the vineyard, the winemaker, doesn't make any wine at all. He just refuses to make and to sell his high-quality top wine. So if you are an expert in wine, if somebody tells you in 1964 there was no wine in Chateau d'Yquem, you can infer the weather you had in France this year. You can say 1964 was a rainy, cold year, and there was no wine. This is indirect evidence. So what can we use as indirect evidence? That it's what we call our tiny companions, or travel companions. We can use all kinds of things who are moving with us. So some people who are working on lice, ovaries and rats, Mathis or Smith, for example. But you can also work with microbes. You can look at the viruses who follow you. For example, just to speak about one, the papillomavirus, responsible from uterus cancer, is a good marker for human migrations. Bacteria, we will focus on Helicobacter pylori, and that's the next slide, I hope. Yes, it is. So this is part of the work I did when I was a young postdoc at that time at the Max Planck Institute, so it's not completely recent. And what I want to show you is if you use, for example, microsatellites, these very polymorphic genetic markers we use in forensics in humans, if you try to separate with a couple of them, a couple of dozen of them, you can very badly segregate Africans from Europeans because we have so few genetic diversity. So you need far more markers. But if you use more sophisticated algorithms, we can do using what you call Bayesian statistics. And don't care about Bayesian statistics, simply it's a question I will do just, I don't want to make a switch between English and French. So at the end, I will make a short comment of my slides in French. I don't want to cut permanently and to switch. I will lose the flow. So now we focus on Helicobacter pylori. And I got a funny question from a journalist yesterday, grand reporter, who asked me, did you make the Helicobacter pylori analysis with the AIDS? Of course not, because this bacteria is sitting in the stomach. So about 50% of the people in the room will have Helicobacter pylori. This bacteria is worldwide distributed, and you can see that the panel of distribution is not always the same. The prevalence is changing. In poor countries, prevalence is high. In rich countries, prevalence is very low. For example, in Paris, in the fifth, I think there's nobody having pylori. I'm sorry. Okay. So it's transmitted usually within families and from mother to child. It's important. It's a transmission which we call, it's a vertical transmission. The opposite is horizontal transmission from person to person without relationships. And this bacteria is highly recombining. So I'm not going to speak much about the bacteria because it's an important disease. It can give you things like gastric ulcer, even lymphoma, cancer. This is why we studied this bacteria at the beginning. But we find out that it's a good tracer for human migrations. One important stuff is when you start to sequence. The first time you sequence this bacteria in stomachs of humans, we thought there was something going wrong. because this is just a DNA sequence. I told you, if I would sequence humans, everything would be the same. No mutations. Here we sequence just a couple of genes in this bacteria, and you have many polymorphisms, a lot of information. And this was surprising to us. So we thought the company was making a lousy work, and we asked them to do it again, but we got the same result again. So we have something very, very diverse sitting in our stomachs and moving with us. So what can we do with this? Well, the idea was first to know how fast it's evolving. We need a clock. If you want to calibrate stories, we need a clock. So we took different patients who were sick, they got treated, and we were checking how the bacteria was evolving during time. So they came back. The first one on the top left came 36 months later back. We sequenced again the same bacteria, and we did a long cohort of people doing so. And what came out from this is when the boxes remained white, there was no change. There was no change between the strain the first and the second time. But sometimes we observed here in yellow point mutations. This means that we had one mutation going on here and one here. This means one mutation occurred. And in other cases, the pink boxes, it meant we have recombination, genetic exchange between lines. So this bacteria is evolving by mutation and by recombination. The same is true for humans. And then we started to see what's the power of this technique to assign a strain. And what you can see here is that if you look at the probability of finding twice the same strain, the probability if you sequence 800 base pairs is something like 10 to minus 3. So we have one chance out of 1,000 to find again the same sequence if you sequence just one or seven genes. So it means there's a lot of information in Helicobacter pylori. Much more than humans. We tried to calculate a mutation rate. So this is an extrapolation. It's quite technical, but we succeeded getting a reasonable mutation rate. And what you can see also that the fragment is recombining is a small chance of DNA recombining, so it's not a big chance. But what's more important is that mutation rate is less than 4 times 10 to minus 5. So what we did next, we started to make a global data set. And this was not easy, because if you want to get this bacteria, you have to make an endoscopy. So you have to go to the hospital, you need a medic guy, and you have to extract the bacteria, you have to grow it on a plate, and you have to sequence it. So it's a long process. But we succeeded, and we had 234 isolates scattered around the world, and we got 1,249 polymorphic sites. This is the picture. If you don't put any color, it's not that exciting. You don't see really a clear picture coming out. And this is the three approaches, which are not the most accurate and powerful techniques to work with. So if you are a population geneticist, you avoid classical tree reconstructions. But one thing which is very interesting is that this bacteria, I will try to explain this slide in details. This is an important slide, so be careful. Every polymorphism is a nucleotide which is different. So this is simply one gene. Let's say this is gene 1. And what it says is that every nucleotide of gene 1, which is polymorphic, was clearly assigned to one population coming from Africa, what you call Africa 2. The guys in blue, it means all the SNPs are assigned to population Africa 1. And what we can see is that in some cases, if you look at the third one on the top, half of it is blue, half of it is red. This means that people from two different ethnic groups came into contact, the bacteria exchanged the chromosomes, and we have a signature of the contact of these two different people from two different origins. So we can reconstruct the history of every single bacteria. Now, if you put colors on the tree, but then it's a bit more realistic, and you start to see things. For example, there's a very different divergent group of Africa 2. This is basically South Africa. You can see the Africans in blue. Europe is in green. And you have the Maoris, finally. We speak now, finally, about Maoris. The Maoris are in the middle, in yellow. And you see they're close to Asia populations. And now I don't speak about humans, I speak about bacteria sitting in Marie's stomachs. So the power we have with this technique is that we can, this is a triangle, this is different summits of a triangle, and you can see if you're purely Asiatic, you are at the top of a triangle. If you are typical African, black African, you're in this corner. And so we can exactly reconstruct the human history and migrations using this bacteria. This is summarized here. You can see that if you are yellow, you have an Asiatic origin. You can see that, for example, Athabasca and people living in Alaska, they have typical signatures of Asia because they went through the Bering Strait. But you also can see that station number 18, Mari, they are typical signatures of Asia as well. This is not yet very detailed, but we will go into details soon. This one is maybe not important today. But you, you can simply see again, if you use a different analysis, that Maoris belong again to what we call ancestral East Asia on the top right picture. Another interesting information that's it's well known in human genetics is that if you leave the Horn of Africa, the genetic diversity is slowly declining. This is what we call the stepping stone effect. You have multiple settlements. So the more far away you are from the Horn of Africa, the less diversity you have. And this is exactly what you observe as well with this bacteria. This is Helicobacter, it's not human genetics. And you can see the highest diversity is in fact close to Sudan and so on, Ethiopia. And the lowest diversity is not far away from South America and also Maori populations. So now, what do we know about the discovery of New Zealand? Of course, it was already mentioned. The second person who really stopped there was James Cook, and the first interaction was not very positive because the first time a Maori was immediately shot. So it was a bad start. But after there was some exchange going on, they were exchanging pearls, they were exchanging tools, nails, and they got heads like we saw, and over also food was important for the sailors. We got pigs and so on. And the map on the right side is a map which was drawn by Cook himself of New Zealand. It's a pretty good map for the first map of the country. As I said, the interactions were sometimes tense. This is the endeavor on the top left. And finally, Cook, as everybody knows here, died when he was in Hawaii during a fight against local people. Now, we will really zoom into the Pacific. And this is certainly the most important slide today in terms of understanding what's going on and the peopling of Polynesia and New Zealand based on the Helicobacter pylori. So we used a sophisticated software, was able to detail we have a certain number of populations. And for example, this is red and this is orange. I don't know if you see the difference, but you should. The first thing you can see is that the people share common ancestors are the people living in Papua New Guinea and in Australia. This is a former continent which was called Saul. Saul was, the sea level was going down 30,000 years ago. So people can, at that time, they were able to walk and to go to the continent. Later on, the water raised again and they were landlocked. This is why we explain they are so different by drift. But interestingly, you can see that the Maori here, they have this typical signature you can find through all the Pacific. But it's also the signature you can find again in Taiwan. So yes, we know Taiwan is the most likely source of the beginning of the spread of the invasion of all the Pacific. Even more interesting, if we go just in Taiwan, you can see my colleagues worked on different ethnic groups. And they were able to say which ethnic group was at the origin of the Maori spread and settling. So it was a Bunun. And the Bunun is a bit paradoxal, they are sitting in the middle of the land. So people would say, why are Bununs in the mountains and they're supposed to be good sailors? In fact, what's often appearing is that these ethnic groups were moved, they had to move and to leave the coast for more modern societies or more powerful societies in terms of army, density, also disease. Now we can try to see some more information. We can extrapolate from FST and gene flow. For example, we can evaluate the amount of gene flow between regions. And interestingly, you can see that there was much more gene flow coming from East Asia towards Polynesia and New Zealand on the opposite side, in the opposite direction. So there's a strong asymmetry in gene flow between different regions on the world. There was nearly no gene flow back when we look at this pattern in the Pacific. Here we have the story, but with calibration clock. So you can see, again, we have the ancestor. If you calculate the ancestors of all Taiwanese and Polynesian people, this ancestor is something about 11 to 12,000 years old. So it doesn't mean that the first people settling New Zealand were here 12,000 years ago, but it means they were sure something between 10,000 years and 5,000 years. For sure. Now, what's the interest of using these bacteria? You can see here a synthesis. So this is another work which I did in Ladakh, in India, but we simply did the same kinds of work. So we compared the information we can gather from mitochondrial DNA, the information we can gather from microsatellites, and from the bacteria to segregate two populations. We failed to find any difference using the classical molecular tools in human genetics, but we succeeded to see a difference using the bacteria. So it's a very good tool for recent stories, like the one going on in New Zealand. Now I give a chance to classical human genetics. This is exactly what my colleagues did before. They were typing the MARIs for these 9 bases per deletions. You remember? Because the band was short or long. And of course, it's not a fully discriminatory power information, because black is a deletion. But you can find the deletion in the Philippines at high frequencies as well. So you have to combine multiple loci and to calculate probabilities to say clearly this head is coming from Maori area, from New Zealand or not. So it takes a lot of analysis. And finally, the last figures I want to show you is a recent paper published in 2008, which is a very large scale analysis in human genetics using 952 microsatellites. This is certainly the best resolution idea we have today. And again, you can see that the Maoris are closely linked to the Samoa using nuclear genes. And finally, the next closest population is Taiwan and Asia. So the story is granted, more or less. You can also use these kinds of analysis. It looks a bit complicated, but it is not. Every single line is one person, one genotype. And depending on the color you have, if you are light blue, you come from Asia. So you start to add the data and ask, oh, how many populations do you see? If you force the algorithm to see 2 populations, you will split Europe, Asia, Taiwan versus the others. And after you can more and more split and split and split, but you can see that the Maoris, they are here. They are nearly always in this group, the violet one, but which is quite closely related to Taiwan. So this is the detail, the most powerful study we can have today concerning the genetic structure of Pacific Islanders. And finally, a last figure. This one just illustrates the erosion of diversity here in heterozygosity. And you can see, if you look at Micronesia, that the diversity is quite low compared to what you can see in Africa here. You can see this, of course, due to multiple stepping stone effects, small population sizes, the genetic diversity got lost progressively as a consequence of this long, long journey out of Africa, which took something like, I would say, 50,000 years, if we grant that New Zealand was settled 5,000 years ago. So thank you very much. So this is my former mentor, Mark Appmann, and now I will try to make a short sketch in French, and I apologize to people who have to hear this again in French. But so
will be very synthetic.
Donc, ce que je vous montre ici, c'est en fait, sur cette figure-là, j'ai insisté sur la notion que la population humaine, l'Homo sapiens moderne, a une diversité génétique très très réduite. On voit que, par exemple, les autres grands primates ont des branches beaucoup plus longues, comme le chimpanzé et le gorille, alors que l'homme moderne a des toutes petites branches, ce sont les branchements rouges. Donc ça veut dire qu'on est passé par des goulets d'étranglement importants qui ont purgé la diversité génétique humaine. Ça, c'est juste une vision que se faisait l'allemand anthropogéniste Ernst Haeckel sur les migrations humaines. C'est un tableau qui a 150 ans, mais qui est presque parfait, qui n'est pas très différent de ce que je vous présenterai tout à l'heure. Donc, important de collecter les groupes ethniques, qui sont des populations d'origine, si on veut retracer l'histoire du passé, et pas des populations modernes. C'est assez logique. Donc ça, c'est juste un tableau des différentes populations qu'on peut trouver. Ensuite, je fais appel à la notion que les langues sont aussi informatives pour mettre en place les connectivités, les relations qu'il peut y avoir entre société, population et géographie. Donc vous voyez en fait en bleu foncé que les Maoris ont eu un langage en commun qu'on appelle l'austronésien avec des populations de Taïwan, de l'archipel de Malais, etc., malaisien. J'ai souligné les limitations de la génomique humaine. Je séquence toutes les personnes présentes dans la salle. Je ne ressens aucune mutation si je fais un ou deux gènes, donc pas d'information. Donc je propose des alternatives. Ce sont en fait les parasites qui nous accompagnent, que ce soit les virus, les bactéries. Même des gens se sont intéressés aux rats, qui sont aussi des commensaux de l'homme finalement. Donc ce choix existe. Ça, je ne vous passerai pas. Donc on a une liste ici de ces organismes qui ont servi de proxy des migrations humaines. Ensuite, je parlais de la bactérie Helicobacter pylori qui est présente dans les estomacs des humains. À peu près une personne sur deux va l'avoir. Cette bactérie est responsable d'adénocarcinome, donne des cancers. Enfin, pas systématiquement non plus. Mais on a travaillé sur cette bactérie. Lorsqu'on l'a séquencée, on s'est rendu compte qu'elle avait une diversité génétique énorme. Et donc, une diversité génétique dit une information, beaucoup d'informations. Chaque polymorphisme est une information. En plus, on avait peut-être de puissance statistique. À partir de là, on a calculé les taux de mutation et les taux de recombinaison. C'est pour calibrer une horloge moléculaire. Si on veut dater les événements, il faut avoir un taux de mutation. Sinon, ça ne sert à rien. On fait avec du descriptif. Et donc, ici, toujours avec cet outil, on est capable de retracer des éléments de recombinaison entre bactéries. C'est-à-dire qu'on est capable de dire telle et telle bactérie de telle population a rencontré une bactérie d'une autre population et une signature de leurs échanges génétiques. Donc là, la conséquence, c'est-à-dire qu'il y a eu un homme, par exemple, africain, qui a rencontré une femme européenne, ils ont eu des enfants, ils se sont mariés et leurs bactéries se sont mélangées. Et leurs enfants vont avoir des bactéries intermédiaires. Donc c'est une information assez intéressante qu'on n'aura pas, par exemple, sur l'ADN mitochondrial, ni sur le chromosome Y, au demeurant. Ici, c'est l'information qu'on a collectée, une phylogénie, lorsqu'on regarde toutes les populations, tous les individus qu'on a réussi à collecter. Donc c'est un travail fastidieux parce qu'il faut faire une endoscopie. Il faut faire pousser la bactérie sur une boîte de pétri. Et ensuite, il faut séquencer 7 gènes de ménage. On a fait 7 gènes. Et on est capable donc de voir qu'on a des populations très éloignées, comme l'Afrique 2. Ça correspond en fait à l'Afrique du Sud. On a des populations bleues. Oui. Et on a finalement en jaune, ce qui correspond aux populations asiatiques, avec notamment les Maoris, qui sont bien dans ce clutch asiatique. On montre sur cette figure que finalement on est capable de retracer les patrons migratoires connus chez l'homme avec la bactérie. Ici, je vous illustre l'érosion génétique de la diversité bactérienne lorsqu'on quitte l'Afrique de l'Ouest. Non, de l'Est, la corne de l'Afrique. Donc plus on s'éloigne de la corne de l'Afrique, moins les bactéries sont diverses. C'est que la diversité est très très faible en Amérique du Sud et également en Polynésie et en Micronésie. Ensuite, je parle des premiers rapports un peu tendus entre James Cook et ses marins et les Maoris. Notamment, il y a tout un cas de décès. Puis la mort de James Cook à Hawaï. Ici, peut-être la diapositive la plus importante, vous voyez finalement qu'on a réussi même à spotter dans la région de Taïwan l'origine, la population source de l'expansion austronésienne, c'est en fait les Bunun. Donc on a plus de précision qu'on ne pouvait avoir avec les outils classiques de génétique moléculaire. Voilà, donc en fait, vous voyez sur la dernière diapositive ici, que l'ancêtre commun de toutes les souches entre Taïwan et le Pacifique a quelque chose comme 10 000 ans. Donc le peuplement des Maoris de la Nouvelle-Zélande s'est fait il y a entre 10 000 et 5 000 ans. C'est dans cette branche qu'on se situe. Voilà, j'arrête là. Je vous remercie.